Very excited to introduce my second novel, a contemporary literary romance called Love Portrait. Okay, so what's Love Portrait all about? Okay. It's a slow burn, romantic contemporary romance, heartbreaking and heartwarming in equal measure. Main character Molly Gould is optimistic, quirky, and a little bit awkward. She drives a vintage yellow mini, the temperament of Daisy May, has a passion for art, red wine, and peanut butter. At a museum job, a new museum job, she is tasked by her boss, the formidable Evelyn Fox, to find out the provenance of a painting of a beautiful woman brought in by the smoking hot investment banker Georgina Wright. Georgina, grieving following the recent death of her father, opens her heart to Molly as they uncover the painting's poignant hidden history of a love lost in the 1830s. Love's Portrait is about the dilemma of falling for someone you work for. It's about sticking up for your principles. It's about making your voice heard. It's about also my very real love for art and museums and my passion for challenging the invisibility of lesbians in history, something I care very much about. Now, I do something a little bit different with Love's Portrait. I infuse a contemporary story with a careful selection of emotional scenes from the 1830s. And indeed, for this excerpt, I've chosen one of these very scenes as I take you back to 1832, to Josephine Brancaster. She bravely tries to do the right thing for her and her love, Edith Hewitt. So buckle in, guard your hearts, as I take you back in time. September 1832, City Walk, Leicester. Edith, wait. Josephine pulled at Edith's sleeve. For pity's sake. Pity? How can you speak of pity? Edith tugged her sleeve free from Josephine's hold. You have none. And you have no sense. Wait. Josephine followed deep after Edith, trying her best for her walking not to become running. Ladies did not run after all. Edith, on the other hand, seemed to find walking at a genteel pace a torture she would not endure. Josephine could just see her head running, weaving through the crowds that had gathered on City Walk, the much-anticipated light on the first gas lamps. Edith? Josephine looked for Edith's shape amongst the pressing throng, so familiar, so loved. She felt a hand slip into hers. She felt Edith's lips warm against her ear. I do not need sense, but my heart tells me all I need to know. Edith lifted Josephine's hand against her chest. Please, Edith, I cannot be strong for both of us. We need to let each other go. Edith gripped Josephine's hand tighter. Why? Why must we? We can build a life together. With her lips pressed in turn to Edith's ear, lest someone in the crowd about them should hear, Josephine gasped, how? With love. Love does not feed us or pay our bills. It does not keep the cruel scrutiny of others at bay. Love will not protect our reputations, Edith. Love is not enough. And let us not forget you have your mother to care for. Your writing will barely be sufficient as it is. I have an endowment, small it may be, but we can make it stretch. We can do anything, be anything. Miss Brancaster, good evening. I thought it was you. William Wright's ruddy-cheeked and eyes bright as if lit by the lamplighter himself, beamed a smile at Josephine. If he had seen Edith, or for that matter, caught sight of her dropping Josephine's hand to her side, he did not comment. What a night! Can you see? I have a spot near to where the lamplighter will rest his ladder with his lamp here. Would you care to join me? Good evening, Mr. Wright. Josephine gave a courteous nod. I'm fine just where I am, but thank you for the kind offer to stand with you. Very well, as you wish, should you change your mind, I'm just there. Good evening to you. William lifted his hat and gave a small bow with his heels clicking softly together before he turned to stand a few feet away. How do you know him? Edith narrowed her eyes, watching him leave as if chasing off the keen bow. I don't know him. He has been working with my father. I believe he's a solicitor. Well, I believe you are causing him to be quite distracted. He has missed that lamp being lit right at his ear, for his attention cannot be drawn from you. I have done nothing to attract his attention. You have my word. Men do not require a woman to do anything. There is a presumption, and I think he is presuming. And he's not the only one. For you are presuming too much for the future. I am not presuming you love me. I know you do. That is not the point. How many times must I say that? Tears force their way over Jotun's lips, squeeze tight in an attempt to hold back a sob. I will not say it again. We cannot be together as we've been anymore. We must stop this. This evening, in fact. Right now. And begin again as friends and colleagues. We must at least try. With a heartbreaking blankness to her voice, Edith said with her gaze dropped to the floor, I can no more stop my feelings for you than I can stop my heart from beating. Jocelyn felt Edith move away. Edith. She reached out and found a hand to hold, just air, empty air bathed in a golden street light.